It is our prayer and our hope that tonight your soul is renewed, that you are able to just hear God's word and be refreshed in community. Say hello to a friend that you've known for a while and make a new friend at your table as well. So we are thrilled to have you. And so would you join me in welcoming our guest, Jamie Ivey.
Hey, ladies. Thanks for letting me come to your church and your town. And I am so happy to be here. And I like that you guys like real people because that is who I am. Like she said, my name is Jamie. And I'll tell you how real I was today because I was driving here this afternoon. My husband and I went on a little lunch date because he got home last night and I left today. It's just the life right now. So we went on a little lunch date and I think I was just preoccupied with, you know, I get to be with my man finally. I get packed up. I forget my computer. So I kind of need that this weekend. So I had to go back, get my computer. And then I'm about 30 minutes away from the church and I'm doing the little mental check in my head. Like, what do I have? What do I need to do? All those kind of things. And then I had the thought, I left my Bible at home. Wow, I'm going to talk to people about Jesus. And I am coming without a Bible. So, praise be to God, Lifeway is everywhere. And so, I have a brand new Bible. Isn't it pretty? How many of you have had your Bible for years and years and years, and the thought of having to get a new Bible just makes your stomach hurt? I hear you guys. This Bible will be used tonight, and then it's gonna look good on my coffee table because it's not mine. It's not broken in, but bear with me because I'm gonna use it. And the good thing is that the books are all in the same order still. So I know where they are, just, you know, because I was in Bible drill. Was anybody else in Bible drill? Y'all remember, I'm gonna get started in just a second, but this reminds me. I was at a church one time talking about Bible drill and there were so many people that didn't know about it that I actually had to act it out. Do you guys remember? You would stand back here, right? For all of you that didn't grow up in the church, this is what we did for fun. We would go to Bible drill and you would stand back here with your Bible and then you were all in a line and then they would say, okay, find the, you know, Sermon on the Mount. And then they would do something, I can't remember, and say go, and then you would da 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 da, and then the first one to step up wins. It was like a competition. So fun. All right, guys, I'm super happy to be here, and the topic about renewing your love is something that I'm passionate about. And one thing that I have realized over the past couple of years, especially through having my happy hour, those were really kind words that she said about the show. And my podcast, The Happy Hour, has been in existence for about 2.5 years. And one thing I have seen happen that I knew God did, but I didn't get to see the extent of it until it now happens in my world every day, is that God does use the stories of his people to renew his people's love for him. God uses the stories of other people to renew our love for him. God uses the stories of other people so that we can bring comfort to people. God uses people's stories so that we can inspire and show people what God has done in our life and how he has been faithful to us. So tonight, I hope as you hear a little bit about my story and we talk about a couple of things, my prayer for you and me, everyone in this room, is that we would leave here tonight loving Jesus more. Anytime I stand up in front of women and open God's word, that is the hope, that we leave here different. That we leave here loving Jesus more for what he has done for us. So tonight I'm gonna talk about a couple of different things. I'm gonna talk about three ways that we as women define ourselves. And I'm gonna say women because I'm speaking to women, but men have their own things. Three ways that we as women define ourselves. And then I wanna counteract those with actually who God says we are and how God defines us. A couple of years ago, I was reading this article and it stuck out in my brain because about 4 years ago, I started working in our city with a nonprofit called Redeem Ministries they help victims of sex trafficking. So if you don't know what sex trafficking is, I'll give you here's what it is. Women are sold for sex trafficking. And what happened to my brain about 4 years ago is I realized that sex trafficking is not something that just happens in Thailand, that it happens in America. And it's not just something that happens in America, it happens in Texas. And lo and behold, it happens in Austin, Texas. So I got immersed in helping this ministry, and I still to this day get to do stuff with them on a different level by visiting women in jail. But I read an article, and the article was about a girl named Jennifer, and Jennifer had been in the life. She had been a trafficking victim for years. She had spent more of her life as a sex trafficking victim than she had not a victim. But something happened to Jennifer is that she got free. She was freed from this life of trafficking. But one thing haunted Jennifer for years. Something that's very common that traffickers will do to their victims is they will tattoo the trafficker's name on the girl. So what this does is it marks her. It marks her. She had a tattoo on her neck of a gang sign. I hope this doesn't offend anyone. She had a tattoo on her stomach that said property of, and then it said a man's name. She had tattoos on her body branding her that she belonged to someone else. I watched a video about her that she talks about it, and Jennifer's amazing because she's now started a whole organization that their whole goal is to provide funds for trafficking victims to have tattoos covered up. Isn't that amazing? Most people are getting tattoos covered up because they were stupid when they got them, and I love tattoos. I mean, see, like, I hope you're not offended. I like tattoos, but a lot of people are, when they get tattoos covered up, is because it was something that they did that they don't really like anymore. They were foolish. They were childish. These women are wanting to get tattoos covered up because they have been marked by a man. I'm going to go out on a limb and say that none of us, not many of us, if any of us in this room, can understand what that feels like. Jennifer says this about her tattoo transformation because she eventually got the names covered up. She got them covered up and they were made into something beautiful. She said, I was branded like cattle. She said, but coming here first time, knowing that when I walked out of the door, I'd have replaced that sign of evil with something that was beautiful and full of life and hope. I knew that I was going to set myself free. And man, that was a great feeling. So Jennifer got her tattoo covered up and she was no longer branded. And I want to talk to us tonight, women, about how we allow things in our lives to mark us. We allow things in our life to determine our value, to determine our hope, to determine our future. We let so much mark our lives that I want to suggest that we let those things go and we begin to trust and believe what God says about us and how he marks our lives. Just to give you a little context, I'll tell you a little bit about my story. I already told you I was in Bible drill, so you know I grew up in church. So I grew up in church. I've been in church since as long as I can ever remember. In fact, some of my memories are Wednesday night supper. Did anyone have that when they grew up? Okay, Wednesday night supper. Now I'm a mom. I get it. This is the most brilliant thing church ever did, all right? Moms would pick up their kids after school, come to church, and dinner was served. Can you eat? Isn't it brilliant? It's brilliant. Now I know why my mom insisted we were there every Wednesday night. So we did Wednesday night dinners, and then we'd go off to GAs or my brother to RAs or whatever else it was we were in, act teens or choir, which is funny for me, all kinds of things that we were involved in. And so I grew up knowing a lot about God. I grew up knowing a lot about God, and I would have told you had you asked me, yes, I'm a Christian. Isn't everybody in this church? Of course I'm a Christian. Of course I love God. But my life began to resemble someone that did not love God and did not know him. Around my 16th birthday, a lot of things changed, and I had this hole in my heart that I was trying to fill. It was like a void. I needed to feel loved. I needed to feel accepted. And I don't think I was following Jesus because he's the filler of that void in our life, and my heart was a void. So shortly after I turned 16, I started a new life. I started partying and drinking. I became sexually active. And what this started for me was a 7-year journey of doing whatever I could to make myself feel loved. Whatever I could to fill that void in my life, whether that was boys or partying or alcohol, whatever it was. But I still would have said, yes, I'm a Christian. I was literally a walking Pharisee is what I was. Because I knew a lot about God, but I did not love him, I did not trust him, and I did not follow him, and my life resembled nothing like someone that loved Jesus. But I grew up in the church, I knew all the answers. Shortly after my sophomore year in college, I was away at a private Christian university here in Texas, and at the end of my sophomore year in college, I found myself pregnant. So now it was as if everything came crashing down. No longer was I the good Christian girl that hid all her sins. Now I was a good Christian girl whose sins were out in the open. Everybody knew now. All of a sudden, everything had caught up with me, and I was at the bottom. I knew that the life I had been living was not filling this void in my heart at all. Shortly after that, I miscarried, and my dad drove up, and I moved home. I left behind that, and I moved home, and it was the loneliest time of my life because there I was back in the house that I grew up in, going to church with my family, but I felt like a fraud. I felt like a joke. The next 2 years of my life was just an emotional roller coaster. I literally was looking. I was looking for everything that this Bible offers. I was searching and I was seeking and I was trying to fill it up because, ladies, I needed Jesus. I needed Jesus to fill that void. I needed to trust and believe that what he said about me was true. So I started searching. I ended up going back into church with my parents, truly seeking God, truly seeking him to define my life. Because you see, my life had been defined for a long time by mistakes. Lots of mistakes, lots of poor choices, pregnant, drunk, partying, broken off engagements. All of these things marked my life for so many times in my life. They marked me and I allowed them to define me. I allowed all of these things to define me. But when I finally surrendered my life to God and said, I cannot do it. I'm at the bottom. I cannot pull this off anymore. I need you in my life. When I finally did that, something happened. And what happened was that my life was now marked by Jesus. Jesus now was the marker of my life. No longer was my life marked by myself, but Jesus was the marker. And I want to tell you, ladies, that all of our lives in here are marked by something. And we all allow things in our life to mark us. Our hearts are marked by something. Our lives are marked by something. Our entire being is marked by something. Your life could be marked by your mistakes, or it could be marked by your successes. Or your life could be marked by how good of a person that you are. Your life may be marked by all that you have accomplished. Your life may be marked by how good your kids are. Or your life may be marked by how bad your kids are. You see, we let these things mark our lives. And what I began to learn as I walked forward with my relationship with Jesus and I surrendered my life to him, what I started to find is that I had to trust and believe his word. I had to trust and believe his word because what I felt about myself was so hard for me to stand on. But I started finding out that what God says about me was worth standing on. When I first committed my life to Jesus, I felt so insecure because of all of the baggage that I brought to the table. All of the stuff that I brought to the table. In fact, when I started dating my husband who worked at a church, which that's fun when you just start following Jesus and you bring a lot of baggage and then you start dating a pastor. I was so insecure, so insecure. I thought literally that when I walked into a room, everyone knew everything about me. I thought I was like Hester Prynne in The Scarlet Letter and that I would have to wear an A on my chest forever. I felt that everyone knew my past and my past had defined me for so long and I had allowed it to determine who I was. And then it started changing. And let me guys tell you, when I started following Jesus, it was ugly, ugly. I know some people, they hear about Jesus and their life is changed and they are immediately walking the other way. I knew all the rules. So when I started following him, it was ugly. I made a lot of the same mistakes, but I was working so hard to follow him. But what happened in me, and it wasn't overnight, is that there was a change in my heart. I began to understand what it meant for Jesus to take on all of my sin and declare me a child and a part of his family. I would read verses that say, God being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us. Even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive with Christ. And I would begin to believe that that was true. I would begin to believe that if he said it, and it's in here, that I can trust it. I began to change what defined me. I began to trust and believe that Jesus marked my life. Because ladies, there's a big difference between what we believe marked our lives and how God defines us. We stand on our insecurities. We stand on our past mistakes. We stand on our wrongdoings, and they will not withstand for you. The only thing that will is God. Galatians says, "For in Christ Jesus, you are all sons of God through faith. For as many as you were baptized into Christ Jesus have put on Christ." God sees us. If you are a Christ follower, when God looks at you, he sees Christ in you. I'm not making it up. It's what it says. It's true stuff. It's true stuff that God is the one that defines us. I told you I'm going to talk about three things. I'm going to talk about that we view our sins as something that hinders our ability to come to God. Sometimes we view our sins as something that determines our value. And a lot of times as ladies, we view our sins or struggles as something that will determine our future. And I want you to hear real quick that my big and bad sins that I just shared with you from years ago, those big and bad, ugly sins, they are not any worse than the sin I had today in my heart. They are not any worse. For you in here, you may be thinking about that one thing so many years ago that no one knows. And if they knew, you wonder what they would think about you. Some of you may have the audacity to think, well, at least I'm not as bad as her. You know you do. I know who you are. I want us to know that any sin in our lives can make us believe things about God that aren't true. Satan loves to convince us that we are not what God says we are. And he will use that against us. Tonight, as we look through these things, I hope that you leave here with a renewed love for what God has done for you. The first way is that we allow our sin to affect our relationship with God is that we believe that our sins hinder our ability to come to him, but God says that Jesus makes it possible for us to come to him. One of the things in my life that constantly was hindering me the most from giving my life over to God and truly following him with everything I had is that I didn't feel worthy to be a follower of his. I didn't feel worthy. You know, I told you I grew up in the church, and so I knew lots of people who loved God and lots of people who did great things. In fact, eventually I was married to a pastor who loved God and did great things, and I still felt as though for some reason my sin disqualified me from letting God love me. I felt that it was hard to go here, and I'm not sure where I got this thinking, and I'm certain that other people in this room have struggled with this as well, because the Bible, it says the exact opposite. It says the exact opposite. Paul, who wrote so much of the New Testament, he declares himself over and over the worst of sinners. He's my favorite because when he sends letters to different churches, every time he's like, I'm the worst sinner. I'm the worst. Which makes me love him because he's constantly declaring, hey, if God can love me, I'm the worst. Then don't you worry, he can love you as well. If you remember, before Paul was Paul, his name was Saul, and Saul persecuted, killed Christians. Saul was standing right there. One of the first times we see his name is when Stephen was stoned to death, and who is there over it? Saul. Saul says, I am the worst of them. Paul writes in 1 Timothy, he says, the saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance. He's telling them, what I'm about to tell you is trustworthy. You can believe me. He says that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. And then he does it again. He says, of whom I am the worst. Paul is constantly declaring that he knew firsthand what it meant to be accepted by God in spite of your sin. He trusted when God says, you come to me because of what Jesus has done. You are not left out of this. I had to learn this over and over and over again. And I have a small suspicion that there are people in this room who feel the feelings of, man, if you knew what I struggled with, you would know why I feel this way. And guys, I have great hope for you is that God knows what you struggle with. God knows the struggles that you have. And God says, because of Jesus, you can come to me. In fact, I was forgetting something all along when I struggled with this, is that here's the deal. We are all sinners. Game over. Everyone is awful. Your kids are awful. Whenever my kids come home and tell me that someone was mean to them, I first feel sorry and I tell them I'm so sorry. And then I constantly think in my head, you are mean too. So I'm sure yesterday a friend was telling their mom about you at school, because we are all sinners, all of us. Everyone in this room has wronged God. Romans 3 says, there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. You see, all of us fall short. All of us. My big and bad sins that everyone saw out in the open, they're the same as that secret thing that you struggle with that you don't have the nerve to tell anyone about. My sin from years ago is just as bad as this morning when I was struggling with feeling pride and left out of something. God died. He sent Jesus to die for all of those sins. And this was a fact that I was constantly having to remind myself about. The truth is that Jesus died for the unrighteous. He died for everyone that's a sinner. He died for my sins. 1 Peter 3:18 says this, for Christ also suffered once for sin, the righteous, which is Christ, for the unrighteous, which is us. And the reason he did that, it says, is so that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit. You know, even though I had so much sin that I was dealing with and baggage that I brought to the table, and still today sin against God all the time, Jesus died for that sin. And let me tell you, if you've grown up in the church, you're sitting here thinking, Jamie, I know what you're saying. This is nothing new for me. I know Jesus died on the cross, John 3:16, I know it all. But ladies, we don't live like we know it. We don't live like we trust that Jesus died for all of our sins. There's great hope though, because John 3:17 goes on to say this, for God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Did you hear the hope that God gives us in that? It is full of so much hope that Jesus did not come to condemn us. Jesus did not come to condemn Paul. Jesus did not come to condemn me or you, but he came to save us. That is such good news. It is the gospel. God sent Jesus and so that we could come back to him. You see, our sin doesn't keep us from coming to God because God sent Jesus. And Jesus brings us back to him. You and I don't have to be defined by our past or our struggles, but we can be defined by Jesus. The reason that the world may declare me or you or anyone dirty or unclean or unworthy, it's because Jesus is the one that makes us whole and clean. Some of you might have a hard time grasping this in here because you live a very great life. But let me tell you, when I talk to my girls at the jail every Tuesday about how much God loves them in spite of their screw-ups, it means something to them. It means something to them because they are sitting in the consequences of their screw-ups. But I want to tell you something, that you and I are no different than them. And let us not think that we are better, because we are not. We are sinners, but there is great hope, because God sent his son, Jesus. Jesus defines us. He is not looking down on you to condemn you or judge you. Jesus is using you to bring glory to God. The second thing is, as women, maybe in this room, maybe just me, you can hear my stuff. The second thing is that our sins, we believe that our sins determine our value. We believe that our sins determine our value, but God says, hey, I determine your value. I get to make that. One of my favorite stories in the Bible is in John chapter 8. Look, I got to open it. Look, it doesn't even hardly open. It's in John chapter 8, and you've probably heard the story, especially if you've grown up in the church, but it is about a woman who is in a terrible situation, and then Jesus steps in and rescues her. He rescues her physically and spiritually, in fact. I'm going to read it with us. If you have a Bible, you can read. If not, it's going to be on the screen with us. Starting in the John chapter 8 says this. But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Early in the morning, he came again to the temple. All the people came to him, and he sat down and he taught them. The scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery, and placing her in the midst, they said to him, "Teacher, this woman has been caught in the act of adultery. Now in the law, Moses commanded us to stone such woman. So what do you say?" So I want to stop right here and look at this woman, and I want you to imagine her with me. This woman has literally been dragged to the front of where Jesus is teaching from the act of adultery. If you need me to break it down, she was having sex. Is that too much? They drug her out. Imagine her scared, afraid, completely vulnerable. Imagine that she felt worthless. Imagine she was very afraid, very humiliated. And if you're anything like me, I would guess that you and I have felt this before. Probably no one in here has been dragged out in the street in front of people demanding your life, but you have felt humiliation from your actions. You felt the feelings of letting those down that you love. You have experienced moments in your life of extreme embarrassment and aloneness. And many of those times have been result of your sin, just like this woman. I remember when I first started going back to church as an adult and really started seeking to follow in Jesus, I was looking for just peace and hope and something because I felt like I was one big walking disaster. I felt like every time I turned around, I was making choices that were bad. And I felt as though when I walked into a room that I was this woman. I felt as though I was standing in front of my peers, but I also felt as though I was standing in front of God, naked, embarrassed, humiliated, ashamed. And I wondered what he thought about me. Can you imagine how this woman must have felt? What is this man that they're calling teacher, this man that's claiming to be Messiah? What does he think about what's happening? You know, let's also know that the Pharisees, they're actually speaking for her to be stoned to death. They are demanding her life. And must it be noted, she is guilty of what they said. This is not like we need a trial. She is guilty as charged. Goes on to say this. Jesus bent down and wrote with his finger on the ground. And as they continued to ask him, he stood up and he said to them, "Let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her." And once more he bent down and he wrote on the ground. But when they heard it, they went away one by one, beginning with the older ones. And Jesus was left alone with the woman standing before him. Jesus stood up and he said to her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" She said, "No one, Lord." And Jesus said, "Neither do I condemn you. Now go and sin no more." You see, Jesus took the law that the Pharisees brought to him, the law that says, hey, Moses said, it's in the Old Testament, if you are who you say you are, then you believe this as well. And she's been caught in the act of adultery and she deserves to be stoned. And Jesus flipped their worlds upside down. The Pharisees demanded justice for this woman. And Jesus says, if any of you are without sin, go right ahead. If any of you are without sin, go right ahead. He said, give her what she deserves. Give her the justice that you're demanding. This is actually one of the stories that I wish I could actually be a part of. Not a Pharisee or a rock thrower, but you know, just like someone on the sidelines. Because can you just imagine the look on these men's faces? They came for justice. They're demanding justice. And Jesus is like, cool, if you don't have any sin, start throwing. And one by one, the rocks began to drop until finally it was just her in Jesus. She's still naked. She's still afraid. She's still humiliated. And now she's standing in front of the Messiah. It's just the two of them. No one was left. You see, Jesus knew something when he stood in front of that woman. He knew that that sin would be paid for because we serve a holy God and God demands justice for sin. Sin will be paid for. But what Jesus knew that that woman did not know and those Pharisees did not know is that Jesus would take the payment for her sin. That the sin would be justified and Jesus would take the payment for that sin. An author named John Bloom writes an article about this story, and he says this: our sins, the dark lust, destructive tongues, murderous hatred, corrupting greed, treachery, they stand exposed before God as clearly as the woman's sins in that temple courtyard. You and I and our sins, we stand before God just like that woman. Our shameful guilt is obvious and our condemnation is justified. And yet, the Son of God comes these stunning words, neither do I condemn you. Why could he say that? He could say that because he has been condemned in our place. Jesus knew as he stood in front of this woman, naked, worthless, embarrassed, afraid, ashamed, he knew, I've got you. I'm gonna pay for that sin. And you're worth more because I choose to pay for your sin. I remember when my husband Aaron and I first started dating, I had just started following Jesus within the past year. I had made a bunch of mistakes in that past year while I was following Jesus because I told you I had kind of a rocky ride getting myself back together. And on our first date, I told Aaron, I said, listen, here, and he works at a church, right? I mean, it's just, praise God, 16 years later, we are still married. He works at a church and I feel like Hester Prime, right? I feel like everyone looks at me like I'm just full of shame. And we're on our first date. We grew up in the Houston area, so we were at Chewy's, which is our first date. And I told him on the first date, I said, look, listen, here's the deal. This is cool. I like this, whatever. I just have kind of a lot of things in my past that I need to tell you. And he's like, cool, go right ahead. I was like, oh, not right now. I'm not ready to do that. And I did that because I was scared and afraid and God had so much work to do in my life, but I was like, I gotta give this guy a chance to get out because this is a lot. And he looked at me and he said, that's fine. Just tell me when you're ready. And I was like, this guy's a joke because who does that? Like if someone said to me, hey, let's date. I got some scary stuff in my past, but I'll tell you later. You cool with that? I'd be like, no, I'm not cool with that at all. Like, let's lay our cards on the table. So he said, no, you just tell me when you're ready. And so that whole next spring semester, I prayed and prayed and prayed. And I was like, God, please, please, please prepare Aaron's heart. Because I just assumed, how could a guy like him who'd never kissed a girl and is a pastor, how could he even want somebody so used like me? That's what I thought. So I was like, God, please prepare his heart. And God, please help me to really trust and believe who you say that I am. So Aaron was a youth pastor, and so that right after in June or whatever, we took all of our students, our high school students to the beach, because that's what youth ministry does. We take our kids to the beach and we say, let's get to know Jesus better and don't look at all the girls in the bikinis. But I guess it's an act of discipline we're trying to teach the children. I don't know. I'm not in youth ministry anymore, but I do have a 13-year-old son, so. We're at the beach with our students and it's one of the last nights and we have communion on the beach and we are praying and worshiping. And before I know it, I'm the last one there because I am completely moved that God is saying, this is the time that you're going to tell this man. And at this point I knew I was going to marry him. And so he comes down to find me and he sits down on the beach with me and we hold hands and we're sitting across from each other. And the only light is the moon and the water's coming in. It could be so romantic, but it was actually so scary. So we're holding hands and I'm sure that he knows. And I say, I'm ready to tell you what I need to tell you. And y'all, I told him everything. everything. There are 8,000 more things I could tell you tonight that you don't need to know or you don't care. I told him everything. And I was so worried that he would think of me the way I thought of myself. And humans do that sometimes. I mean, let's just be real, right? He's not God. And in that moment, Aaron looked at me on the beach and holding my hands with tears in his eyes and tears in my eyes. And he said to me, he said, you know what? That is not even the Jamie that I know. So you have nothing to be ashamed of. And in that moment, it was the first time that an earthly person had looked at me and said exactly what God thinks about me. That God looks at me and says, you are not who you think you are. You are not defined by your past. You are not defined by your mistakes. You are not defined by your failures, but you are defined by me. You are defined by me. On that day, my sins did not determine my value before God. My sins don't determine my value before him now, but yet only Jesus has the ability to determine our value. So we cannot be women that believe the lie that our failures and our struggles and our sins determine the value that we have before our Father. Because God says, nope, it's my job. I determine who you are. The third thing that we believe is that our sins determine our future. And God says, I determine your future. You know, if I were completely vulnerable and honest with you, which I think I have been tonight, but I would continue to tell you that forever I believed that God probably would not use me that much because of my past. I believed that I would never be worthy enough to do anything for God. I believed I could be a good wife and a good mom and a good pastor's wife, but God, would he ever use me? Would he ever use me with the mistakes? And then I would continue to read the word of God. And I would continue to see that God is not concerned with our past, but he is concerned with our futures. He uses all of us. God is the redeemer. God is the redeemer. He redeems us of our past and then he uses us for his great works. Because here's the deal, guys. If you're thinking that you're too messed up to come to Jesus, then you're wrong, because no one has ever come to Jesus that's not messed up. Nobody. Everybody in this room, we are messed up people who need Jesus every single day. And so I don't know why for years I believed that my sins would keep me from my future, when actually God says, hey, I came for the sinners. I came for the sinners. In Matthew, when Jesus met Matthew, who would later become one of his disciples, he was met with a little bit of confusion about why he was hanging out with Matthew. Matthew's a tax collector. They were usually thieves. I'm not saying anything about anybody these days. The sinners and the Pharisees, they were the enforcers of the law. All of them are saying to the disciples with rather confusion of why Jesus, who says, I am the Christ, I am the Messiah, who's hanging out with Matthew, the tax collector, they're saying to the disciples, they're saying, hey, why is this teacher of yours eating with the tax collectors? And then Jesus heard this and he said, those who are well have no need for a doctor, but those who are sick, he says, for I came to call the sinners, not the righteous. He said, I did not call the righteous, I came to call the sinners. Guys, we need to own the fact that we're all screwed up sinners and God called us and he will use us for his glory. That's what he does. Time and time and time again, we see people in God's word who mess up royally and God used them to change the world. God used them to change the world. We already talked about Paul. You know, Acts 9, he talks about, we learned about all of his life and how he murdered Christians. He demanded the deaths. No one in their wildest dreams would believe that man would be used by God to build the new church, the early Christian church. Can you imagine with me what it was like the first time Paul walked into the synagogue? Well, it says in the Bible, we don't have to imagine it much. People were like, is that the guy who's killing people? I'm out, is what I would be thinking. I'm out. But God used Paul to change the world. And Paul is a messed up person, just like you and I. I like David a lot. You know why I like David? Because I relate to him. Because you know what? I screwed up a lot when I first started following Jesus. I made some of the same mistakes I'd lived in forever. And David, God says, he's a man after my own heart. And David loved God, and he messed up. And God still used him. Because that's what God does. Because if God used people who had no sin, we would not need Jesus. God sent Jesus for us because we needed him. Paul was a walking example to the new church about how through faith you were saved, not through our works. You and I are walking examples to the world. If you are a Christ follower, you're an example to the people around you that God can use you. When we mess up, when we struggle, we don't need to be women that hide that, because guess what? When we share our struggles, you know what we do? We show people Jesus. We give God all the glory, just like Paul, just like Matthew, just like the woman caught in adultery. We are all in need of a Savior, all of us. Some of you in here, you're thinking, I can't really relate to the woman who was caught in adultery, and I've never killed anybody like Paul, and I've never slept with someone else's husband like David. And you may be thinking, I'm not really like any of these people that you're mentioning, so I'm really not that bad. I have friends that used to think that. And then they started to really dive in, and they started to see that God says in his word, even on your best days, your righteous deeds are like filthy rags. On my best day, when I'm like mom of the year and everybody has a lunch and everyone's to school on time and everyone's laundry's put up, and when they come home, I'm happy to see them. And then we play games. And then I never get upset with anyone. And then I read everybody a chapter of the book we've been reading for a couple of months. And then I tuck everybody in. On my best day as a mom, my righteous deeds are filthy rags before God. So everyone in this room relates to this, because we are all in need of a Savior and we are all sinners. And what I want us to remember, what I want you to know as you leave this place, is I want you to know that when you start to feel as though the sins and the struggles in your life determine your value, I want you to remember that that is not true. Just like Jesus told this woman her value in John 8, because he knew he would die for her, you know that Jesus determines our value. When you start to feel as though your sins and your struggles determine your future, I want you to remember that God uses people to change the world. And the only kind of people that live in this world are messed up people, so we're all in this together. God uses us to change the world. God has a plan for you. And it is not the plan that you sometimes believe about yourself, because God loves you and he values you and you are special and you are chosen. And you can change the world. Some of you are going to change the world in your house with babies. Some of you are going to go to other parts of the world. Some of you are going to go to Michigan. I don't know why you'd go to Michigan, but you might. They need new water, so some of you are going to go do that for them. But ladies, as we leave here, I want you to think about what is marking your life. What are you allowing to mark your life? Just like Jennifer at the beginning when I was talking about how she literally had her trafficker's name marked on her body, and that, she felt, was her definer, was a name marked on her life. But ladies, I want to ask you, are you letting Jesus be the marker of your life? Are you letting him be the marker and the definer of who you are as a person? Because let me give you a small secret right here. When you begin to trust and believe that what God's word says about you is true, there's freedom in that. There is peace in that. There is hope in that. So my prayer for us, for you and for me and everybody in your city and everyone that comes to your church and everyone that you get to be around, I hope that we will be women that trust who God says that we are. Because that is something that we can stand on. Let me pray for us. God, we love you so, so much. We are so thankful for your word. We are thankful for your word because it is truth. And God, we are thankful for your word because it is something that we can stand on. God, I pray for the women in this room and for myself. God, I pray that we will not be women who allow our lives to be marked by things that are not true. God, my prayer for these women and for myself is that we would step into the faith of believing that what you say about us is true. Because God, we only get one life. God, let us live it to the full and abundance that you've given us to us. And God, let us be women who trust you. God, thank you for your son, Jesus. Thank you that because of him, we can come to you. God, thank you that because of him, our life has value. And God, thank you that because of him, we can change the world and do great things. We love you, God, and I pray all this in your son's name. Amen.